Treasury. As a member of the House Select Committee on Intelligence, I've traveled to countries around the world and had the benefit of receiving briefings from multiple agencies to understand the means and tactics used by terrorists, drug traffickers, human smugglers, and other bad actors who threaten our national security. One thing I've learned from these briefings is that all of these criminal organizations have one thing in common. Their unlawful operations are supported and financed through money laundering. Treasury plays a vital but often overlooked role in combating terrorist financing and money laundering. In particular, the Office of Terrorism and Financial Intelligence works to protect the integrity of our financial system using a variety of tools and authorities. TFI's activities range from economic and trade sanctions administered and enforced by the Office of Foreign Assets Control against targeted foreign countries, terrorists, and others who seek to do us harm, to the collection and analyst of intelligence and financial information that can be used by law enforcement to investigate financial crimes and money laundering. The fiscal year 2019 omnibus appropriations included an increase of $17.2 million above the FY18 levels for TFI. This additional funding supported the newly established Terrorist Financial Targeting Center, a multilateral effort between the U.S. and Gulf Cooperation Council countries to counter terrorist financing and provide a substantial enhancement to Treasury's programs in targeting North Korea. From the limited information we have so far in the Department's fiscal 2020 budget request, I am pleased to see continued recognition of the important work you do with a proposal for modest increases above FY19 for TFI and FinCEN. Lastly, I would be remiss if I not take this opportunity to comment on the recent announcement of Treasury's intent to divert $601 million from the Treasury Forfeiture Fund to pay for the construction of physical barriers along the southern border. These funds are typically used to augment funding for critical Treasury and Homeland Security operations such as in IRS criminal investigations, Title III wiretaps, and Electronic Crimes Task Force. In fiscal 2019, Treasury's budget request stated its intent to use available funds to support investigations and other activities to combat money laundering and terrorist financing. The recent decision to redirect these funds toward border fencing recklessly undermines the ability of Treasury and Homeland Security to address known threats against our financial system and the nation. Before I turn to our witness for their statement, I would like to recognize Mr. Amadei. Do you have a statement on behalf of Mr. Graves?
Mr. Chairman, thank you. I want to apologize for my tardiness, and you've covered it pretty well, so I have no statement on behalf of Mr. Graves, and I yield back. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Undersecretary Mandelker, thank you for being here today. Without objection, your full written testimony will be entered into the record. With that in mind, we would ask you to please summarize your opening statement in 5 minutes.
Thank you very much, Chairman Quigley, and distinguished members of the subcommittee. I want to begin by expressing my gratitude for the committee's strong and continued support for Treasury's Office of Terrorism and Financial Intelligence. We are very proud to work closely with the Congress across U.S. national security and law enforcement agencies, and also with our foreign counterparts to disrupt malign activity and to safeguard and strengthen the integrity of the U.S. and international financial system. It is an honor for me to be the Undersecretary of TFI during our 15th year. Although TFI itself is a relatively recent creation, it actually has its roots in the 1940s, out of an effort to prevent Hitler and the Nazis from seizing U.S.-held assets of countries as the Nazis invaded them. In a novel use of our tools then, the Treasury Department officials used the emergency powers of the United States to freeze those assets. In fact, they were able to freeze billions of dollars to keep them out of the hands of the Nazis. Treasury moved swiftly then, and we move swiftly now, as we are constantly working to keep funds out of the hands of dangerous actors around the world and to change their behavior. I am humbled to supervise TFI's career officials within OFAC, FinCEN, the Office of Intelligence and Analysis, and the Office of Terrorist Financing and Financial Crime, including the Treasury Executive Office of Asset Forfeiture, or TEOF. These dedicated public servants work day in and day out, often behind the scenes, to keep America safe. They work at an increasing pace to implement our complex authorities, and our successes are a testament to their skill and dedication. TFI's economic authorities play an increasingly central role in countering some of the nation's most critical national security and illicit finance threats. This last year has undoubtedly been one of our most active. We have reimposed nuclear-related sanctions against Iran, brought maximum pressure against North Korea, targeted major Russian companies, oligarchs, malicious cyber actors, and many more, ramped up our efforts worldwide to combat terrorist financiers and narco traffickers, as well as their networks, taken unprecedented action to hold human rights abusers and corrupt actors to account, reinvigorated our work with partners to strengthen domestic and international anti-money laundering, countering the financing of terrorism, safeguards, among many other things. We are also increasing our efforts to share information with the private sector. We have issued multiple advisories on issues ranging from corruption in Nicaragua, Venezuela, and South Sudan, to illicit maritime networks, to the deceptive practices that Iran uses, among many more. With each of these actions, we are strategically calibrating our economic tools and authorities across our components, and all of our efforts are underpinned by bilateral and multilateral engagement with partners, with civil society organizations, including efforts that we undertake to share information with other governments to work together to disrupt specific threats. We, again, greatly appreciate the confidence and support of this committee, as the chair already mentioned. In the last two budget cycles, our appropriations have continued to increase, and we are using these funds to ensure that we remain agile and responsive to a wide range of national security and law enforcement objectives, and that we are innovating and adapting at a faster pace than our adversaries. These budget increases are critical to supporting our workforce and our mission. Thank you again for your support, and I look forward to answering your questions.
Thank you so much. We have some members who need to move on to other hearings as well, so I'm going to move forward with others first. And I'd ask, given that consideration, that we observe the five-minute rule. And so we ask the members and witness to try to keep their questions, especially in the first round, to that 5 minute. Mr. Cartwright.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Thank you for being here, Ms. Mandelkar. I want to start with the Financial Crimes Enforcement Network. It recently made a statement jointly with regulators of federal depository institutions encouraging banks to implement what they call, quote, innovative approaches, unquote, to meet Bank Secrecy Act and anti-money laundering compliance requirements, with the goal of better identifying and reporting money laundering, terrorist financing, and other illicit financial activity. Can you provide us examples of some of the innovative approaches that you're seeing?
Thank you for that. For that question, this is actually, we thought, was a very important effort. It's the first time that you've had all the federal banking agencies, along with FinCEN, which is part, of course, of TFI, coming out with a statement like that where we're encouraging innovation. We have had a number of financial institutions come to us with innovative ideas. I don't think at this point I'm at liberty to tell you what those are, given what those discussions are like, but we're happy to come in and talk to you about it more. You know, I believe that we're going to be that much better at the end of the day detecting money laundering, illicit activity, if we give financial institutions the incentive and the space to engage in all that more sophisticated activity to detect those crimes. And we've seen a lot of great innovation coming out of financial institutions, and I look forward to seeing more in part as a result of that statement.
Yes, I welcome working directly with you. Yeah, off script. And you mentioned the participation of depository institutions, and I want to ask you, what level of participation are you seeing from banks in conducting pilots and other innovative approaches?
So that was in part the purpose of the statement. We want to make sure that financial institutions have the space to pilot these kinds of innovative approaches without feeling like they're going to be dinged, so to speak, in an examination because they've undertaken these kinds of pilots. We've actually received great feedback from financial institutions that this has gotten a lot of attention at senior levels of the banks because, you know, we do have a lot of people in financial institutions who have a sophisticated background in how to use financial crime units within their organizations to ferret out that kind of illicit activity. So again, we're happy to have a discussion with you about what kind of pilots we're seeing because those are, you know, conversations that we have in confidence with those financial institutions, and we're in the process of evaluating those. I'd rather not speak about it here, but happy to have further conversations. And what I can tell you is there's a lot of really good work that's happening in the compliance community to incentivize, even more sophisticated work in this space.
Good. Yes, let's talk offline on that as well. And I want to move to this question of AI. I notice in the joint statement it is mentioned that some banks are experimenting with artificial intelligence to strengthen and enhance compliance measures. Can you explain, as best you can publicly, a bit more about how these types of systems are being used?
I'd leave it to the comments I made before, and again, happy to have other conversations with you. But the bottom line here is that, you know, as actors, illicit actors, are becoming all the more sophisticated in trying to get around our rules, our laws, we have to be many steps ahead of them. And so when it comes to whether it's the use of artificial intelligence or other technology to detect that kind of activity, we think it's important. The other effort that a lot of the banks are now undertaking is they're forming under an authority that was pursuant to the Patriot Act, they're forming consortium where they're actually able in certain circumstances to share information with one another.
With each other.
Yeah, exactly. So that, and when you do that, of course, you can detect a broader pattern of activity, which we think is a really important development. And when they do that and they give, it not only does it enable them to harden their networks, but they also provide information back to us through suspicious activity reports and other reports that have been crucial in our ability to take down or with law enforcement broader networks.
Well, I'm glad to hear that. So one bank can say, well, we're seeing that too, and that gives added credence to a particular threat. Well, thank you for being here, Secretary, and I yield back.
Thank you, Mr. Amade.
Thanks, Mr. Chairman. Madam Undersecretary, I want to kind of go to the FinCEN area as well for a minute, and I want to talk about banking and marijuana. Not my cup of tea, no pun intended. Understand Schedule I's floating around out there and the Congress has or hasn't done or is going to do some things. But I'm talking now as somebody who has reached out and had FinCEN come in for briefings about, hey, how you doing this and what's going on? Because we get that federally regulated banks are sensitive to what FinCEN has to say about things and stuff like that. But I'm looking at least in the neighborhood that I travel in, a situation where, for instance, let's take Wells Fargo. Hasn't had a great couple years, so they're really, really conservative on that Schedule I stuff, and we can't. Okay, I get that. But then you get another bank who says to the plumber, who may have done work on rental property for the landlord, which is leased to somebody who grows or distributes King's X. Okay, I think. Maybe not okay. But I want to get right to the point here, which is when those folks who are operating in states under a privileged business license are paying local governments, state governments, and the federal government their taxes in cash, which are then put in depository institutions, there is no scrutiny whatsoever. It's okay to take cash from a licensed marijuana grower if you're the state of Nevada and you deposit it in, pick the name of the institution, and there's no examination issues, there's no FinCEN issues. Clearly, Schedule I prohibited substance tax revenues, while there is for all these other things. So I'm not trying to put that all on you because Congress has to fill a void. I get that. But right now, status quo is if you're a government entity putting your cash for marijuana in a federal depository institution, as near as I can figure, it's just fine. Help me. Why are all the private sector people being told, figure out a way to launder your money, but yet the government political subdivisions are said, pay the IRS in cash? And as a matter of fact, some of them are overpaying them and getting Treasury checks back, so we've essentially laundered the money for them.
So I want to make clear what our role is in this area and what it isn't. So of course, it continues to be a crime, as you know, under federal law to engage in certain activities related to distribution, et cetera, of marijuana. Nothing that FinCEN does or can do in this area changes that. That continues to be the state of federal law.
Understood.
And in that context, of course, banks have to make their own decisions about risk-based decisions, as we ask them to do in a variety of circumstances about what they are and aren't willing to bank. We don't tell them what to bank. They make those decisions based on a variety of circumstances, including their concerns about whether or not engaging in certain types of banking is going to bring regulatory scrutiny on them, or alternatively, the concerns that it may be involved in money laundering or other illicit activity. What FinCEN did in 2014 was issue guidance to financial institutions about the kinds of SARs that they should file, related to guidance that was in connection with guidance that the Justice Department had put out at that time related to what they were and weren't going to prosecute. That guidance remains in place. We haven't changed it. We continue to review it. But as you mentioned, this is really something I think that Congress needs to look at, because nothing that we do can or does change what is prohibited under federal law. And of course, it's really up to the Justice Department to make those decisions.
And I don't mean to cut you off, but my time's a little limited.
Sure.
I would like to request a copy of the guidance, if that's appropriate, from your office to the guidance you put out in 2014. And then I would also like to do one follow-up, which is, has FinCEN done anything in a disciplinary sense against any banks that are taking deposits for the U.S. Treasury or for any state treasury or for any local government treasuries in states that have legalized marijuana?
So happy to provide that guidance. It's also available on our website. We can give a copy to you and to your staff. What we do with the suspicious activity reporting that comes in connection with that activity is we analyze it, of course, and law enforcement, I think, believes that analysis is valuable to them. We also have to understand that any activity related to narcotics can also show other illicit activity that we all
have. I appreciate it, Madam Undersecretary. I would just do one more request before I yield back, which is, could you please let us know if there have been any SARs filed by any financial institutions with respect to deposits made by the federal government, any state government, or any local government? Do you have in your system any SARs filed for deposits made by political subdivisions that are affiliated with the marijuana industry?
So what I can tell you is, of course, we have a number of SARs related to the marijuana industry, as we do in a wide range of activity. With respect to your specific question, we're happy to get back to you.
Thank you very much. I yield back, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Mr. Bishop.
Thank you very much, Mr. Chairman. Welcome, Ms. Mandelka. Ms. Mandelka, on February 28th, 2019, there was an article in the New York Times that described how Internet companies like Facebook are planning to roll out new cryptocurrencies over the next year that are meant to allow users to send money to contacts on their messaging systems, like Venmo or PayPal, that can move across international borders. Facebook, for example, is working on a coin that the users of WhatsApp, which Facebook owns, could send to friends and family instantly. Given the reach of Facebook, as well as the current lack of central authority, like a government or a bank regulating them, What are the potential vulnerabilities of a Facebook coin to money laundering? How would it be regulated? What can be done to make cryptocurrencies less vulnerable to criminality and scammers? Does FinCEN or other investigative organizations monitor public blockchain networks for potentially illicit transactions? And I'm going to ask my second question. One of the preferred methods of money laundering is through real estate, which can offer stable values or appreciated values and also anonymity if they're purchased through shell companies. Real estate is also functional in that a money launderer could use the property as a second home or rent it out, earning income from the investment. Those transactions are also less subject to scrutiny when they're compared with transactions related to banks, which have a legal requirement to report suspicious activities. What tools do you need to bring these transactions to the light of day?
Thank you very much for both questions. So just starting with the virtual currency aspect, I don't want to comment on any particular organization's efforts in the virtual currency space. But what I can tell you, what I can tell you is that this is a very heavy effort, a focus of ours. So among other things, for example, I have a group of people in that stretches across all of my components that are looking every day at the illicit activity related to virtual currency. FinCEN actually was one of the first regulators in the world to look at this issue and take it very seriously. And in about 2014, FinCEN issued guidance that said that virtual currency administrators and exchangers are the same as money transmitters, which effectively meant that they had to have compliance, AML, CFT compliance programs, just like other money transmitters. They have to have internal controls, they have to have compliance officers, they have to file suspicious activity reports. In fact, we've gotten thousands and thousands of suspicious activity reports as a result of our efforts. In addition, what we've been doing systematically with IRS criminal investigators is examining virtual currency administrators and exchangers. And we say that any virtual currency administrator or exchanger, if it transits currency through the United States, has to have those kinds of controls, regardless of whether or not they're headquartered here in the United States. So we're examining them in our supervisory role. We're also brought examination enforcement cases against certain virtual currency administrators and exchangers. We also have a very big effort globally to get other countries to do the same, because bad actors are always going to go to the lowest common denominator. So this year, we hold the presidency of the Financial Action Task Force, which is the international standard-setting body for AML, CFT, and one of our three top priorities is to encourage other countries to do the same. We could talk about this for a long time. What I can tell you is we're tracking it. We're working very closely with law enforcement to do the same, and it's a very heavy focus for us. In terms of your question on real estate, that's also another area of focus. So you may be aware that we've issued a number of what we call geographic targeting orders, which is an authority that we've gotten from Congress that requires in certain jurisdictions title insurance companies to provide information to us very specifically to address the problem that you've identified, which is the use of shell companies to buy property, real estate, using cash. Those title insurance companies have to provide reports to us about who the beneficial owners are, among other areas. We've also issued an advisory to the real estate sector to help them identify red flags that they need to be alert to make sure that they're not being used to funnel money. It's a big effort of ours, and it's going to continue to be.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Ms. Joyce.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Ms. Mendelkar, thank you for being here today. I was, as you were well aware, opioids are having an epidemic effect on our states. And I was wondering if you could explain to us what role the Treasury might have in helping federal, state, and local prosecutors in trying to figure out the organizations, one. Two, how they're trafficking or laundering their money through communities and the things that they're doing. you know, similar to what you might have seen in, you know, obviously there's TV shows that have shown different ways that they're doing it. But most importantly to me is what are we doing to counter the effects of the Chinese importation of fentanyl and carfentanil, which is the deadliest thing out there today?
Thank you for your question. So opioids and illicit narcotics as a general matter is a very big effort for us. So among other things, we have an authority under the Kingpin Act, which has been historically our most active OFAC program, where we have systematically targeted narcotics traffickers, international narcotics traffickers, and their networks in a variety of different ways. So we have sanctioned a number of trafficking rings and the financial infrastructure that supports those trafficking rings all over the world, including in the last year, we sanctioned a big fentanyl ring out of China. So it is the Chinese. We're very focused on the Chinese fentanyl issue and problem, and we're going to continue to be. In addition, what we've been able to do as when it comes to understanding those networks and those rings is taking the information that we have through the BSA, the suspicious activity reporting and otherwise, analyzing the information, and as appropriate, we share that with our state, local, federal partners, because we think we bring a particular type of expertise into how they work and they operate, and sharing that knowledge base is we think of high value. So we're going to continue to be focused on the opioid crisis. I think what the other piece of it that we've been able to bring to the table is the work that we do with our foreign counterparts. So it's often the case that we will take action, and that action will spur the action of other counterparts in countries. We also work very closely with law enforcement in those countries to take parallel action, to share information with them as appropriate, so that they can use their effective tools to do the same.
Certainly the seizures that have taken place of the drug itself is one thing, but as you're well aware, to really try to stop the program, you got to seize their assets and the finances that are moving around. And, for one who has been a local prosecutor for 25 years, I was really interested in that sharing aspect, because obviously you're in a position to make that available. When the feds came to me, the first question I would have is, what's wrong with this case? Because if it was good, they would have taken it in the first place. I would like to see more of that sharing, because I think that it's the most important thing we can do is continue to work as a team on all those things and try to seize as many of their assets and break them up accordingly, because that in seizing those assets and getting them back in the communities that are being hit by this epidemic, I mean, we're losing people at too far a high rate today. One thing that's needed is treatment, and that requires dollars. And so it'd be nice if we could continue to seize those assets. Any thoughts on how we could get that accomplished?
Look, I agree with you 100%. I'm also a former prosecutor, and I've seen how much more impactful we can be when we are able to take those kind of actions, because they hurt people's pocketbook, and that's another disincentive, so to speak, to engage in that kind of activity. Again, I think what we bring to the table is that on the FinCEN side is the information that we're able to share through our analysis, and then on the OFAC side, it's going after being able to designate and sanction the financial infrastructure that supported those networks. So just in the last year, for example, we had a big case in Mexico where we didn't just go after the known sort of narcotics traffickers. We went after the companies, the shell companies that were behind those traffickers. We went after some very significant, got a lot of attention internationally, some very significant individuals who were helping to be used as a cover for narcotics rings, and that similarly is going to continue to be a big effort of ours.
Thank you. Keep up the great work, and I yield what no time I have left back, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Mr. Chris.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and Deputy Secretary, thank you so much for being with us today. My home state of Florida recently legalized medical marijuana overwhelmingly at the ballot box. Currently, our state is home to 14 lawfully licensed and regulated cannabis companies. By 2020, data suggests that the regulated cannabis market in the state of Florida will be about $880 million. So between the economic impact and the benefit to seniors, veterans, persons with certain disabilities, and other conditions, I think it's safe to say that medical marijuana is extremely important in my state. And yet we are currently having no banks, none, that publicly extend financial services to any of these lawfully licensed and regulated businesses in Florida, essentially treating them like criminal enterprises that your office may have to approach. I guess imagine for a moment that every lawfully licensed and regulated marijuana business in the state of Florida had open access to banking, and every dollar of every transaction were banked, traced, and taxed within our banking system. Would this give your department more control and oversight over illicit activities that contribute to the problem of financial crimes and money laundering?
So thank you for that question. What I can tell, what I mentioned before earlier in the hearing is I think it's important to understand what our role is in this area and what it's not. So of course it's still a federal crime to engage in certain activities related to marijuana. Nothing that we do in this area changes that. And of course what financial institutions have to do as a result is make their own risk-based decisions as to what they do want to bank and what they don't want to bank. There are a number of financial institutions actually who are doing banking in certain respects. I can't speak to what's happening specifically in Florida. In 2013, I said 14 before, but it was actually, in 2014, FinCEN did issue guidance, and that guidance very specifically identified for financial institutions what their BSA obligations are relative to the marijuana guidance. And they did that at the time because the Justice Department had come out with parallel guidance about what they do, what they are, and what they're not going to prosecute. That guidance effectively just told financial institutions, gave them guidance on what kinds of suspicious activity reports they should file in connection with certain types of marijuana-related activities. It didn't change federal law. It just provided that kind of guidance. And that's really the role that we play here. We do get suspicious activity reporting related to marijuana business, among a wide variety, of course, of other kinds of activity. Law enforcement has access to that suspicious activity reporting, as they do across many, many different other areas. And we'll continue to play that role, which is to be the recipient and analyzer of that kind of data. But at the beginning and the end of the day, I think this is really a question of what is and what isn't permitted under federal law.
Can you discuss more broadly how the current lack of banking access may be contributing to the problem of financial crimes and money laundering, and how giving access to businesses operating legally under state law would help your office better carry out that work?
So, Congressman, I'm happy to come back and have a discussion with you about that. We're happy to take that question and do additional analysis. Some of that may be law enforcement sensitive, of course, and it's not something I could share with you today. But we're happy to have further discussions with you about it.
When you do get those reports of suspicious activity, what do you do with it?
So our BSA database is actually available to a wide range of federal, state, and local law enforcement officials. So it's not just a matter of what we do with it. It's also a matter of, you know, how federal, state, and local law enforcement officials look at and analyze that data.
I appreciate that, but you're here today. So what, if anything, do you do with it
when you get it? We track the data. In a lot of different areas, we do analysis of the data because we think it's helpful both to federal, state, and local law enforcement as they're investigating money laundering. Similarly, within TFI, generally speaking, we use the BSA database to support many of our activities. You know, one thing, of course, in the narcotics area that we're always looking to see is whether or not the activity is contributing to other criminal activity, organized crime, and what have you. So it depends on the data, but we do spend time and effort analyzing it and using it and providing it to other law enforcement partners.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. I'll take a turn. Let's step back more broadly, looking at the issue of money laundering. Large foreign banks, if they were to launder money for a U.S. person or a U.S. entity, what tools do you have in place and systems that will detect this activity? How do we even know they're doing this?
So we have access to a great deal of information related to banking activity and other sanctions evasion activity, whether it's information that we have through the BSA database or information that we have from law enforcement partners or information that we have vis-a-vis the intelligence community. So as you know, I have an intelligence agency that sits under my supervision, and that has been extremely valuable in our efforts to counter illicit finance all over the world. So we bring all that information together, we analyze it, and we make decisions about what to do with it. So just as an example, yesterday we sanctioned a Russia-Venezuela bank in connection with our Venezuela program. Similarly, we've sanctioned other banks in Russia and elsewhere where we have found or detected that they've been engaged in illicit money laundering in different programs.
What type of activity would trigger your awareness of this?
So it's really would be across a wide spectrum of our programs. So whether it's in connection with North Korea, whether it's in connection with what's happening in Venezuela, whether it's in connection with the illicit activity that we see in our Iran program and counterterrorism, for example, among other areas, narco trafficking or what have you. And I have teams of people in TFI who are focused on very specific areas, national security areas, law enforcement, narco trafficking, human rights and corruption. The other thing that we've been able to do quite with great impact is use a tool that we have that FinCEN has under the Patriot Act called Section 311. And that authority allows us to call out financial institutions or jurisdictions who are engaged in money laundering. We say they're a primary money laundering of primary money laundering concerns. And when we do that, there are a variety of different measures that we can take under that tool that relate to the ability of those institutions to continue to do business with the United States. And we've used it to great effect. So last year, we used the 311 authority to go to do a rulemaking in connection with a bank in Latvia, where we had seen that particular bank engage in a wide swath of illicit activity related to North Korea, related to Russia, related to and elsewhere. Similarly, actually, my first week on the job, we did a 311 action against a Chinese bank that we had found had ferreted a lot of money illicitly to North Korea. And those kinds of actions have had wide-ranging impact, not only in the particular institution, but they also send a message, I think, worldwide that the United States isn't going to tolerate that kind of illicit activity, and we're going to take action where we think it's
just
necessary.
For the 100 level,
yeah.
How did you detect that they were doing that?
It's a combination. It would be a combination of information that we have through the Bank Secrecy Act. We also have information that we're able to use through the intelligence community, among law enforcement, among other sources.
It's something. It's typically transferring money, and you're able to detect that.
We have a lot of tools to detect how financial institutions are operating.
It's a new world with all sorts of new currencies, and how are you able to keep up with encryption and so forth. I mean, what tools do you have to match what the bad guys are using?
So in a very similar way, so as I mentioned before, we get a lot of reporting from various industries. So for example, in the virtual currency space, we get reporting, BSA reporting from exchangers and administrators. We get information. We're able to share information. We also get information from foreign counterparts. And information that we have through in partnership with law enforcement and other national security agencies.
Thank you. Ms. Torres.
Thank you for being here with us. I represent California's 35th Congressional District. We have seven freight corridors, massive logistics industry. So it is a fairly targeted area for the Mexican cartels to move around narcotics. I'm very concerned with the asset forfeiture account. I know that in previous years, the Treasury has sought to maintain a minimum of $100 to $150 million in the TFF for operating expenses. This year is at $71. So, I'm concerned about that remaining balance and how much would really be available. My local agencies use asset forfeiture funding to work on these major crimes. I'm also concerned with the president's decision to spend up to $601 million on a border wall, taking that money out of TFF. Can you tell me what other law enforcement activities will not be supported in fiscal year 2019 as a result?
So in any given year, we have been able to fund, depending on what's remaining in the Treasury Asset Forfeiture Fund, we've been able to fund a range of different kinds of activities, including actually in a number of areas, we've actually taken similar steps, which is we've been able to support other border security-related programs. So as you know, DHS is a very active participant in the Treasury Forfeiture Fund, and we get requests from CBP, from HSI, to fund certain kinds of programs, and that's what happened in this instance. We got a request from the Department of Homeland Security to use a big chunk of the terrorist forfeiture fund for in relation to border security. In many years in the past, actually, we haven't had those kinds of funds available, either because we didn't have as many inputs into the Treasury Asset Forfeiture Fund.
So was that just surplus?
And also because there have been a number of rescissions that Congress has taken to the Treasury Asset Forfeiture Fund. So in certain years, we've actually had nothing available because of those rescissions, or we've had a minimal amount that we've been able to use in this context. So this year, we're actually fortunate that we have a larger amount of money that we can use for those kinds of projects.
I'm going to be keeping on a close eye, and I'll probably follow up with you on that because it is a critical piece of infrastructure that my local jurisdictions use to deal with human trafficking and drug trafficking within my district. McNixie Act in Central America. I'm very focused on the Northern Triangle issues of very corrupt governments in that area. I am concerned that out of the 101 people that are on the list right now under the McNixie Act, there is only one person from the Northern Triangle and a total of two from Central America. Is that correct?
I'd have to go back and look at the actual numbers. We have had we've had a number of actions against individuals engaged in human rights or corruption from the general region.
Right.
And what you also have to look, so we take certain actions under the Global Magnitsky Act. We also have other authorities that we can use to similar effect. So we've actually designated well over 500 individuals and entities in connection with human rights and corruption Many of those haven't been under the Global Magnitsky Act. They've been under other under other executive orders and statutes.
At fiscal year 2019, NDAA included an amendment, which I author, requiring the State Department to provide Congress with a list of corrupt elected officials within the Northern Triangle. That list is almost a month overdue. I guess the shutdown really had an impact on them. Will you commit to working with us to ensure that we move forward and impose the Magnitsky Act on some of these very corrupt officials that are causing a crisis for us at the southern border?
Absolutely. We're happy to do so. What I can tell you is that we have seen that when we use those authorities in that region and others, it can create real change.
Yes.
And I'm very committed to using these authorities in that way. So we're happy to do that and happy to have other discussions with you about
dealing
it.
Dealing with the root causes of migration has been a priority for me, and I hope to work with your office to continue that work. Thank you, and I yield back.
Absolutely.
Thank you. Our members have one more round. Mr. Amade.
Thanks, Mr. Chairman. Madam Undersecretary, to make sure that I understand, FinCEN doesn't have prosecutors. You guys are kind of an administrator. If you get a SAR that you think is a smoking gun, my words, not yours, you forward that on to the appropriate people, for instance, at Department of Justice. Is that correct?
So we don't have prosecutors. We do have enforcement authorities that we use in connection with financial institutions that
are. What is that authority? What can you do to somebody if you think they're breaking the rules?
Well, we have an authority to take enforcement action against financial institutions that don't have AML, CFT, internal controls that meet up to our regulatory standards.
So that's an administrative sanction, not in the nature of petty offense, misdemeanor,
no,
felony
that's,
in
that's
federal
that's exactly
court.
Right. That's right. So, and the Justice Department and many other law enforcement agencies have access to the BSA database. So we maintain the database. It's our responsibility to make sure it's secure. We do a lot of analysis of the information that's in the BSA database, and we work with our law enforcement partners to analyze that data. We often analyze it and provide that to a wide range of law enforcement partners, but it's the Justice Department that would be prosecuting those cases.
Okay.
Criminally.
And so I'd like to finish with, and FinCEN has stopped by my office before to help me understand some stuff, which, as you can tell from my questioning, I'm not doing well with, but not FinCEN's fault. But anyhow, we'd like to follow on if I could get after the hearing the contact of the person to
Absolutely.
Set that up to do that discussion offline. I'd appreciate it. Thank you very much.
We're happy to
I
do that.
I yield back, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. So our sanctions are important. They're our policy. They're the effort short of war to get other countries to do what you want to do. And to punish those who have misbehaved. But obviously, the countries and individuals we have sanctions principally use money laundering as a means to avoid this. I'd like you to talk about how you address this, and particularly use Russian sanctions as an example of your efforts.
So we, every day, we work to make sure that we are using our sanctions authorities consistent with what, with our national security and illicit finance priorities, consistent with what Congress wants us to do. What we always strive to do is to make sure that we're using the authority to actually carry out a particular strategic or tactical objective. So, for example, I'll just take the Russian bank that we designated over the summer in connection with the North Korea program. So there we saw illicit activity happening through that particular financial institution. We designated it, and actually a couple months later, the Russian government pulled its license, so it's no longer, so that it would no longer be operative. We've also been able to use our authorities in a variety of different sophisticated ways. So there are many. Most of our sanctions are effectively blocking actions. We designate an institution or a person; they're no longer able to access the U.S. financial system in areas where we have secondary sanctions authorities. That has an even greater effect because it it puts those banks or companies to the choice of either doing business with the United States or doing business or not. And it has a spiraling impact and effect. In the Russia context, we also have a different kind of tool, which is what we call sectoral sanctions, where in connection with certain types of industries, in energy, defense, in finance, we've been able to launch these sectoral sanctions where we limit their ability to engage in certain types of debt, among other things. So we use different tools depending on the program.
I want to talk about the tactics used to evade sanctions. I mean, shell companies going through other countries. You've sanctioned XYZ Corporation. They transfer all their assets to ABC, which has been sitting in Cyprus as a corporation with absolutely no history. I mean, how do you detect that kind of effort, and what other tactics do you see the Russians using to avoid these sanctions?
So really, as I mentioned before, we have an approach of using all source information, whether it's information that we get through the BSA database, it's information that we have because we do have an intelligence agency in TFI, which is unlike any finance ministry in the world. No one else, as far as I'm aware, has the ability to access that. Whether it's because we work with foreign partners who also share information with us. We've become increasingly, I would say, sophisticated in our abilities to detect that kind of shell company activity. So, you know, when we go after a particular target, it's often the case that we don't just sanction the individual, we sanction the financial infrastructure, whether it's the shell companies, front companies that are being used to ferret money all over the world. And by doing so, by OFAC putting those entities on the list, we make them radioactive all over the world. The other thing that happens when we designate particular entities is there's a whole compliance community out there that takes the names that we put on our list, and they do their own analysis as they're advising the compliance sector, whether it's financial institutions or other companies, about how to keep themselves out of being caught up in the web of those kinds of shell companies and front companies. And as an example, you mentioned Cyprus. So we've been working with Cyprus to keep bad to really push them to keep bad money out of the country, because that's been a historic problem. Similarly, as I mentioned, the 311 action that we took, where we called out a bank for being a money laundering concern, was in Latvia. So in that instance, we were able to identify this bank in Latvia that had been used to engage in money laundering in the Russia program, in the North Korea program. And because we took that action, it actually had a big impact on the Latvian banking sector and ultimately in Europe. And what we've seen as a result of not only that action, but as a result, of course, of some other scandals that have come out, real reform efforts underway in Europe, which is part of what we want to do. You know, we want to work with other counterparts to make sure that they are not vulnerable to the movement of money, whether it's illicit movement of money, whether it's coming from Russia or elsewhere.
Thank you. Ms. Stewart.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. I'm sorry I came a little late to the party. Like many others, we're kind of juggling schedules, but a little thank you. I'm going to start with a proposition and then give you an opportunity to respond, and I'm going to make this simple. This is just, you know, for people like me, just normal, everyday, average Americans to try and wrap their head around something, because I think sometimes a narrative is produced which isn't accurate. And let me start with this. I would argue that this president has been tougher on one of our global adversaries, Russia, than many presidents have been now. I would say a generation or more. And I'll give as evidence of that. First, the kinetic weapons to the Ukraine, whereas the previous administration refused to do that, sent MREs and really nothing else. The reinforcing of NATO, going to NATO and challenging them to pay their dues, the 2%, which is, of course, the whole purpose of that is to counter Russia's influence in Eastern Europe and Western Europe. The the missile defense shields throughout Europe, the European-Russian initiative, again, to build and counter Russian influence. I think even energy policy. I think the most important sanction we could put on Vladimir Putin is to keep the price of energy, price of oil, at $50 a barrel. Their incredible reliance on that for their foreign currency, including discouraging Germany and other European nations from being so reliant on Russian sources of energy. So on one hand, you have this these policies that are enacted that are meant to counter the influence of Russia. Now, break. The narrative is that this president sometimes is weak on Russia, and that is created sometimes because of the lifting of sanctions. And, you know, recent example in January with Rusal, the metals producer. Help us understand the thinking behind that, that on one hand you want to counter them, but you justify lifting these sanctions so the American people can understand that.
Sure, I'm happy to do so. So what we had with Rusal, EM Plus, and another company called the ESE, we had these companies were designated purely because this guy Oleg Deripaska, who's an oligarch who we believe is responsible for a wide range of activity, was designated back in April. So the way our rules work is if you are an entity is 50% or more owned or alternatively controlled by a designated person or entity, they automatically get on our list. So that's why those three companies were designated. Following that set of designations, we engaged in months and months of negotiations. They came in, the companies came in to us with a delisting petition.
When you say the companies, who do you mean?
The
two entities you do.
Right, exactly, and as well as an individual who was leading that effort, who's chairman of the holding company, EN Plus. So we engaged in months of negotiations, and what we did in the course of those negotiations is push them into an agreement whereby the designated person, his ownership fell under 50%, and we took a number of very significant and really unprecedented steps to sever his control of the companies. Effectively, what we were able to negotiate was, among other things, a Western foothold into those companies. So whereas before he controlled the boards, among other things, today half of the board of the holding company is U.S. Or U.K., which is quite significant when you think about the fact that these are major Russian.
How were those board members selected, those Western board members, the U.S. or U.K.?
So those board members were selected by the company. What we did was we vetted those. So we told the company, whether or not a particular board member would pass our vetting. And what each one of those board members are required, the independent board members are required to sign affidavits effectively that say that they are not controlled or won't be influenced by this individual.
And are you satisfied that they are?
We're going to continue. What I'm satisfied is that we have very significant and substantial measures to continue to monitor compliance. So we inserted into the agreement things we've never done before in any program, the ability, a great amount of auditing, a great amount of transparency, and we've signaled in a wide variety, very clearly, much more than a signal to the companies, that if they don't comply with the terms of what was a very significant restructuring and very significant corporate governance changes, then we'll take swift action up to and including putting them back on our list. So now you have these boards, again, with the infuse of Western influence that are on the hook to us, to OFAC, to abide by the terms of the agreement. The other thing that we were able effectively to negotiate was have a very significant chunk of the shares of the holding company are now voted by independent U.S. parties. So I'm not aware of any enforcement action, whether by us or the Justice Department, where we've been able to effectively negotiate terms such that a huge chunk is voted by independent U.S. parties.
Thank you.
Ms. Torres.
On money laundering and real estate, so we have the GTO that revealed about the role of money laundering in real estate. So Los Angeles metropolitan area was just added to that. Can you talk to me a little bit about that?
Sure, I'm happy to do so. So we have this tool, again, these geographic targeting orders, which allow us to require in particular types of companies to provide information to us here about the beneficial owners of shell companies that are used in cash, when they purchase real estate by cash. And we take that information in. We do a lot of analysis. We've expanded the GTOs, as you've mentioned, to identify information from other jurisdictions. We've also lowered the threshold of what it's title insurance companies that are required to give us this information. We've lowered the threshold in terms of the dollar value of the cash transfers. And what we do is we use that information, we share it with law enforcement, we analyze the information, and ultimately it informs whether or not our thinking on whether or not we should make regulatory changes. Yet the other thing that we've done, which I mentioned before, is that we issued guidance to the real estate sector to help them identify money laundering in connection with real estate transactions. And I think that advisory likewise has been quite helpful.
Is that the principal source? And how does it impact our current state of the housing market and rents?
So I can't tell you how it impacts the housing market and rent. We're happy to see if we have information about that. That's not really what we do. What it does impact is our ability to understand how real estate transactions are used in order to identify money laundering, so illicit activity.
The bigger picture for us in California is we're working on addressing the issues of homelessness. Mm-hmm. We want to make sure that, you know, we're checking every box and how are these purchases making an impact, a negative impact into the housing market, and how is it affecting our constituents?
So again, that's not my area of expertise, but I'm happy to go back and see if we have anything about that.
Thank you. I yield back.
Mr. Joyce.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Madam Undersecretary. Terrorists and international crime organizations have used different methods in which they to avoid detection by the Treasury. Can you explain the threat posed by these alternative remittance channels that they've been using?
Sure. So we've actually had a number of actions in which we've gone after money service businesses and any other money transmitters, hawalas, that have been involved in helping to funnel money for groups like ISIS, Hezbollah, Al Qaeda, and you name it. We're tracking that kind of activity. Of course, you know, terrorists are always going to try to find new and different means and methods to evade detection. And what I can tell you is that we have a great ability to see and understand what they're doing, and we work consistently to try to disrupt that kind of activity. Whether it's action that we take through a sanction, for example, or whether it's information that we're able to share with our foreign counterparts to encourage them to take action. So one thing that we've just in the example of ISIS, one thing that we've been able to do in strong partnership with a number of other countries is to set up a multilateral body called the CIFIG, where we work very closely with a number of other countries to share information on how ISIS moves its money, to work collectively to take action with other countries to help inform their prosecutors about actions that they should be taking to keep ISIS and others from being able to transmit that kind of money, whether it's through money transmitters or in other means.
And realizing that you can't really elaborate on some of this, but to the best that you can answer it, the terrorist financing targeting center, your activities that you've done on that, and the other question is, what methods are these groups using to obtain these funds that they need to push on to their groups throughout the world?
So the Terrorist Financing Targeting Center is a new initiative that we've been very grateful to this subcommittee to help us fund. It's a partnership with all of the GCC countries, where we come together in a center, but also another multilateral or bilateral engagement to take action to disrupt terrorist financing through that region. So as a result of, and it's really unprecedented, we've never had that kind of partnership. We've never been able, I think, in the past to get all those countries in one room to focus on this effort. So among other things, we've had three rounds of sanctions that we've taken multilaterally with all of those countries related to ISIS, related to AQIP, related to Hezbollah, the entire GCC with us, for example, designated Hezbollah's Shura Council, which we thought was a very important effort. The other thing that we've been able to do, and that was really one of the objectives of the TFTC, was to do a lot of capacity building. So we want, many other countries to have the same kind of tools and methods to detect and disrupt terrorist financing. So we had a week, for example, we had a week-long training here in Washington over the summer with all of those countries. We're doing another workshop, two-day workshop with those countries later this month, where we'll be presenting information about what we're seeing, and other countries will be doing the same. What we really want that center to do, and what we're striving towards, is to use it to root out terrorist financing in the region. And I think we're making great strides. We have a long way to go, but this effort has really been instrumental to our ability to do so.
In raising those funds, is that through drug sales, and what are the ways are these organizations raising their money, if
it's
you can
through,
explain?
It's through a wide variety of means. So without a doubt, there's been criminal activity that's enabled terrorist financiers to get access to money. Of course, traditionally, we've been able to stop this, but ISIS, because it had territorial control over certain regions, had access to oil revenues, right? That's no longer going to be the case, but they use extortion, they use kidnapping, they move money through charitable organizations that are really fronts for terrorist financing. They get money from government. So, the Iranian regime, of course, has spent hundreds and hundreds of millions of dollars supporting terrorist activities, terrorist organizations like Hezbollah, Hamas, and others. So some of it is state-financed, which is, more than an outrage. So we're taking a number of actions with partners in that region, but also elsewhere, to really put pressure to disrupt that kind of movement of money. I'll give you one example of an action that we took in October. So we had this international identified and disrupted this international network where you had part of it, you had Syria, Iran, and Russian companies working in concert to help move Iranian oil through Russia to the Assad regime. You had actors in the Central Bank of Iran that were helping to facilitate the movement of that money. You had a company in Iran that had the name Medical and Pharmaceutical in it, as if that's what it was doing, that was helping to funnel money to a company, bank accounts in Russia, that then moved money to a subsidiary of the Russian Ministry of Energy. We designated that subsidiary that resulted in enabling oil going to Syria. At the same time, that same international network, which was led by a Syrian businessman who's now designated, was able to work to move hundreds of millions of dollars through certain means through Syria onwards to Hezbollah, the Quds Force, Hezbollah, and Hamas. So they operate in a variety of different means. In that case, we call that an oil for terror network, and that's what we're working every day to try to shut down, not only through Treasury tools, but in concert with a number of other interagency and international partners.
Please keep it up. Thank you for your testimony here today.
Thank you.
Back.
Thank you. Thank you to the members for participating, the staff for putting this together. Madam Undersecretary, thank you so much for participating and for your service and for all who work with you.
Thank you.
Meeting's adjourned.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.